Hello, this is Professor Kitch. Welcome to this webcast on section 11.1. This is the second of two webcasts on Terzaghi's consolidation theory. In this webcast, we'll solve the differential equation we derived in part one and do some computations. To solve the differential equation we derived, we'll need to apply certain boundary conditions, and it's critical that you know these boundary conditions. You're also expected to distinguish between a doubly and singly drained system and find the maximum drainage path for a given problem. And finally, you should be able to apply this solution and compute the excess pore pressure as a function of space and time during consolidation. Here's the differential equation we derived in the previous webcast. First, we'll notice that the solution to this differential equation must be a function of both z and time, since it contains partials of the excess pore pressure with both z and t. As you'll recall from your differential equations class, a specific solution to any differential equation requires application of boundary conditions. So let's define our boundaries. To do this, let's consider a compressible layer that has a free draining material on the top and the bottom. In the field, this would be a saturated clay with sand layers on the top and the bottom. The hydraulic conductivity of the sand is so much higher than that of the clay, it's essentially freely draining. We need to define a few new variables. First, we'll define the depth into the compressible layer from the top of the drainage boundary as z sub dr. Next, we need to introduce the concept of the maximum drainage distance. This is the longest path that any molecule of water has to travel to get out of the compressible soil to a free boundary. In this case, it should be obvious that the water above the middle height of the clay layer will travel to the top boundary, and the water below mid-height will travel to the lower boundary. So the greatest distance that any water molecule has to travel is from the middle out, and the maximum drainage distance, h sub dr, is half the thickness of the layer, or the layer has a thickness of 2 times hdr. So with zdr and hdr defined, let's determine our boundary conditions. We have 3 degrees of freedom in our differential equation, so we'll need 3 boundary conditions. We'll use the top drainage boundary first. If this is a free draining boundary, then the excess pore pressure must be zero at this location for all time. That is, UE at ZDR equal to zero for all time T is equal to zero. Our second boundary condition is similar and comes from the lower drainage boundary. In this case, U sub E for Z equal to 2 times HDR is zero for all T. For our third boundary condition, we'll consider our initial loading conditions. Recall that we assumed that delta sigma z was applied instantaneously, and this caused an immediate increase in the excess pore pressure equal to delta sigma z throughout the compressible layer. We can write that as UE for all z at time 0 is equal to the constant U sub I, and UI is equal to the applied stress delta sigma z. So now we have our boundary conditions, and we can find the solution to our differential equation. As you know, the best way to solve a differential equation is to find a mathematician who's already solved it for you. Seriously, we've got much more important things to do rather than solve differential equations. Hang out with friends at the pub, find a friend's new post on Facebook and like it, send a few tweets, get to level 250 in Candy Crush, or just enjoy a cold one. So, to leave you time for the finer things in life, here's the solution to our differential equation, which is equation 11.17 in your text. This might look a bit complicated at first, but really it's not that bad. It's a series solution, and these terms are just counting constants that are a function of n. For example, the first term is equal to 4 over pi when n is 0, and 4 over 3 pi when n is equal to 1, etc. The 3 key variables here are U sub E over delta sigma Z, ZDR over HDR, and T sub V. All 3 of these are formulated as dimensionless variables. T sub V is called the time factor and is our dimensionless measure of time. It's equal to C sub V times time over HDR squared. You should check the dimensions of T sub V and satisfy yourself that it is indeed dimensionless. Our dimensionless depth is ZDR over HDR, or the relative depth into the clay layer. and our dimensionless measure of excess pore pressure is UE over delta sigma z. Since our solution is formulated in terms of dimensionless variables, we only have to solve it once. We can use the dimensionless solution for any case we're interested in by converting the dimension variables in our particular problem into these three dimensionless ones. Here's our solution to equation 1117. Using this figure, we can determine the excess pore pressure in a consolidating soil layer as a function of both location and time. The vertical axis represents our dimensionless depth into our compressible layer, ZDR over HDR. Using our doubly drained example, ZDR over HDR equal to 1 would be the midpoint of our layer, and ZDR over HDR equal to 0.5 would be a fourth of the way into the layer. The horizontal axis represents our dimensionless excess pore pressure, that is, the current excess pore pressure divided by the initial excess pore pressure, which was generated immediately after loading, or U sub E over delta sigma z. So at U sub E over delta sigma z equal to 0.5, half the initial excess pore pressure has been dissipated and half of it still remains. The curves in this figure are called isochrones because each represents a specific point in time. For example, this isochrone represents the time where the time factor, TV, is equal to 0.2. The isochrones represent increasing time from right to left. So if we want to know what the excess pore pressure was one quarter of the way down from the top of the consolidating layer at a time when the time factor is equal to 0.2, we'd start at ZDR over HDR of 0.5 and draw a line to the isochrone where TV is equal to 0.2. Then we draw a line down to the x-axis and find out that the ratio of the current excess pore pressure UE to the initial excess pore pressure delta sigma z was 0.55. We'll do an example later to clarify this computation. I think it's helpful to do a little illustration to explain how the excess pore pressure is changing within the clay layer during consolidation. Let's consider this clay layer. Since it's doubly drained, the height of the layer is twice the maximum drainage distance, or 2 times HDR. We're going to consider the cross-section AA prime and plot the excess pore pressure along this cross-section at various points in time. We'll start immediately after the fill is placed. At this instant in time, the excess pore pressure jumps to the initial condition and is equal to the applied stress, delta sigma, across the entire height of the clay layer. At some time later, T1, some of the excess pore pressure will have dissipated. At the two boundaries, it will be zero because the boundaries are freely draining and force the excess pore pressure to zero. It will be greatest at the center of the layer, which is furthest from the drainage boundaries. At some time later, T2, there will be an additional dissipation of excess pore pressure, and our isochrone might look like this. The pore pressure continues to dissipate. Eventually, all the excess pore pressure will dissipate. Theoretically, this takes an infinite amount of time, but from a practical standpoint, it is finite. So the isochrone in our dimensionless solutions represent the actual dissipation of excess pore pressure in the field. So let's solve part of example 11.2 from your text as an illustration. Here we have a compressible layer 10 meters thick, sandwiched between a sandy silt and a silty sand layer. We propose to construct a 3.5 meter thick fill on top of the sand layer. Let's compute both the total and excess pore pressures at points A and B in the clay layer at a time 10 years after the fill has been placed. First, we must determine the drainage conditions. Since both the sandy silt below the clay and the silty sand above it will have hydraulic connectivities much greater than the clay, it's safe to assume that the clay is doubly drained. In that case, the maximum drainage distance will be half the layer thickness, or 5 meters. Next, let's compute the change in vertical effective stress, delta sigma z. This will be the unit weight of the fill times the height of the fill, or 19.7 kilonewtons per meter cubed times 3.5 meters. Which is 68.9 kilopascals. We'll be using figure 11.4 to solve the problem, so we'll need dimensionless values for all our variables. First, we'll need to know the dimensionless time, T sub V, which is C sub V times T over HDR squared. We're given C sub V as 3 times 10 to the minus 3 meters squared per day. The time is 10 years, which we need to convert into days, and we divide by HDR squared, or 5 squared. The resulting time factor is 0.44. We'll compute the static pore pressure before consolidation simply as gamma water times the height of the groundwater table above A, which will come out to be 69.6 kPa. To determine the excess pore pressure, we'll need our dimensionless depth, Z sub F over HDR, or 5 over 5, which is equal to 1. We'll then go to figure 11.4 and draw a line at ZF over HDR equal to 1. We want to know the answer when TV is equal to 0.44, so we'll have to interpolate between the 0.4 and 0.5 isochrones. We'll sketch in our own isochrone at TV equal to 0.44. Where this isochrone intersects the blue line, we'll draw a vertical line down to the x-axis and see that it corresponds to a value of UE over delta sigma z of 0.43. So our dimensionless excess pore pressure at point A is 0.43, and we compute the true pore pressure as 0.43 times delta sigma z, which is 68.9, and get 29.6 kPa. And the total pore pressure at point A, 10 years after the fill is placed, is simply the static pore pressure plus the excess pore pressure, or 69.6 plus 29.6, which is equal to 99.2 kPa. We'll repeat this process at point B. Here, the static pore pressure is 9.8 times 2.5 plus 2.1, or 45.1 kPa. Our dimensionless depth at B is 2.5 over 5, or 0.5. So now we enter figure 11.4 at ZDR over HDR of 0.5. We find where that line intersects our interpolated isochrone of TV equals 0.44, and we find that UE over delta sigma z is 0.31. So with this value of UE over delta sigma z, we compute the actual excess pore pressure as 0.31 times 68.9, which is 21.4 kilopascals. And our total pore pressure at B is 45.1 plus 21.4, or 66.5 kPa. We can also answer the question, when will the pore pressure at point A be 10 kilopascals? To do this, first we must compute the dimensionless excess pore pressure, which will be 10 over 68.9, or 0.15. We then go to figure 11.4 and enter at UE over delta sigma z equal to 0.15, and find the point where this line intersects ZDR over HDR is equal to 1, which is the dimensionless depth of point A. At the intersection, we interpolate the time factor to be equal to 0.87. So we know that T sub V is 0.87, and we convert that back to the true time with the equation that T is equal to T sub V times HDR squared over C sub V, which will be 0.87 times 5 squared divided by 3 times 10 to the minus 3, or 7,250 days, which is equal to 19.8 years. So all we need to do to solve a consolidation problem is change the actual variables into dimensionless variables, go to figure 11.4, input 2 dimensionless variables, and get back the third dimensionless value. We then convert that dimensionless output back to the true value we want. It's really pretty simple. Let's look at one more case before we conclude this webcast. Here we have a singly drained compressible layer. On the bottom, it's underlain by an impervious material, perhaps something like a dense shale, and on the top, it's overlain by a freely draining sand. The longest path that any water molecule will have to travel to exit the clay layer is now the full height of the clay layer. The solution to this problem will be exactly the same as a doubly drained case, except that HDR is now the full height of the clay layer rather than 1/2 the height of the clay layer. Let's look at the distribution of excess pore pressure along AA prime for this case. When the fill is placed, we'll again have a uniform initial excess pore pressure equal to delta sigma z. As time goes on, the excess pore pressure will dissipate. But this time, the maximum excess pore pressure will be at the impervious boundary at the bottom of the layer rather than in the middle of the layer. The isochrones in this case are the same as those in the figure 11.4, except we need to consider just the upper half of the figure. All the equations are the same. We just have to use the correct HDR in our calculations. Let's take a moment now and review the original assumptions we use in Terzaghi's consolidation theory. First, we assume the soil was homogeneous and isotropic. This may be a reasonable assumption depending upon the site. If we have a site with only one major compressible soil, this might work. If we have a site like the Kansai Airport site, this won't work. Our assumption about soil saturation, incompressibility of solids and water, and Darcy's law are all reasonable for soils below the groundwater table. The assumption that the load was applied instantaneously will depend on the actual construction sequence. Sometimes projects take years to complete, and this assumption is not valid. The assumption that all the total stress change is initially transferred to excess pore pressure is usually okay. However, our assumption that soil properties C sub V and K don't change isn't so good. We saw that C sub V is really a function of the effective stress, which will be increasing as the soil consolidates, and obviously the hydraulic conductivity will decrease as the soil consolidates. Finally, our assumption of 1D consolidation and flow generally seems to be satisfactory. So the biggest uncertainties in determining the time rate of consolidation are the homogeneity of the site, the rate at which loads are applied, and how soil properties change during consolidation. So let's summarize. The solution we've developed to the consolidation differential equation is appropriate for either a doubly or singly drained system. It assumes the initial excess pore pressure is uniform and equal to delta sigma z, which corresponds to a quickly applied load. If we have different drainage conditions, or if the load is applied gradually, this solution is not appropriate. Our solution is in the form of dimensionless variables for time, depth, and excess pore pressure. And we can use figure 11.4 to determine the excess pore pressure for any location within consolidating layer at any time.
Es ist doch, es ist doch, es ist doch, amigo.